Smoking is fine.
If you want to lose your teeth. Real pros shoot their crystal. Maximize the effects. Saves money.
I'm not that desperate.
Dionysus raped me.
What?
It took what he wanted.
He does what he wishes.
It's not okay.
He is Lord.
So you're not upset.
You can sneak out with me.
Would you really do that for me?
This is Dawna Lee Heising with Ion Entertainment, and today we're thrilled to have our special guest, legendary actor Domiziano Arcangeli.
Thank you. Thank you for the legendary. My God, I'm...
Well, what age did you start at?
10 years old. So now it makes sense. Now that I'm 150... I should be legendary just for that.
Well, no, actually, Domi works more than anybody I know. And I do want to announce that Domi is up for 3 EOTM Awards. And you tell us what they're for.
Well, I'm actually, first of all, I must say I'm humbled and very, very grateful for these awards to EOTM. Did I spell it right? Okay. It's a fantastic group of people. It's an honor to be nominated for 2 awards, 2 best acting awards. One is for a movie that I also produced, and it's called The Ghostmaker by Mauro Borelli, which was released by Lionsgate. It's a movie that, you know, somewhat... for me, at least, in the United States, did not get as much attention as it should have had, because it's a fantastic film, brilliant, very well shot, and I'm so happy to have gotten these awards for the acting, because I rarely like to watch myself in films. Well, The Ghostmaker was an exception. I really enjoyed the performance, and I really enjoyed watching the movie. Mm-hmm. I hope this helps the movie to be more seen. It's out there. It's available everywhere on stream or on from Netflix to any DMV store. So.
And it's a great story. So check it out, people.
Thank you. And the second, it's for Waiting for Dracula. Mm-hmm. A very fun, delirious comedy. I guess, you know, today, everything that has shock value and deliriousness to it, you know, like grabs the attention, because we live in a world that is so over the top. Mm-hmm. And so everything makes sense. It was written and co-directed by Steve Oakley, who's been a longtime friend, and of course, you know, is the, you know, like reality TV mogul, everybody knows, but is also a director, has been a director for many years, and also co-produced by Melanie Grounder, his partner, and for that movie, I'm also up for a Best Director nod, which I must say I'm very surprised, very grateful.
And it was your first movie directing, right?
Absolutely, yes. I never even thought I was going to ever direct. You know, I respect too much directors in a way. In this way, I think really movies are mostly a director job at the end. And as you know very well, since you worked with me and you worked so much lately anyways, a director is the helm of the whole picture. I mean, we could be doing any classic adaptation, but if there is no director, you know, sort of like helming and giving a tone to whatever we were saying, could go to waste. So the director is key. And, you know, thinking about directing, acting, writing, I know there have been and there are actually people doing that very often. Well, from Warren Beatty, who was one of my favorite actors in the past, and Woody Allen, but now a lot of younger people too, and with good results. I never thought I could, because I use, when I act, I use a very instinctual identification and sight sort of method, which is my thing that I developed, I guess, to to help myself during the years, you know, also when maybe you're not in such a great movie or you're not having the luxury of having such a well-written character, and you have to make up for that as an actor. And that happened many times. So I mean, it's sort of very instinctual what I do, but it requires a lot of attention, a lot of.
So when your character's not well written, then you use your method to make the character better.
Yes. Yeah. I try to.
Because you always stand out on screen.
Ah. Well, thank you again. I really thank you. Really sweet. But most of all. I think I try to give those missing layers that today get overlooked so much. Mm-hmm. You know, psychological passages, they expect you to you know, transition between happiness, joy, to maybe, you know, sadness, to make it really simple, without a key factor to really get this reaction from you. And I think, you know, it's a major, when you as an actor realize that there is a major plot hole or something really not working as well in the script. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm sorry to say, I'm really sorry to say, I'm not being sarcastic or anything. I mean, it's happened a lot lately. It didn't used to happen when I was younger, for example. It
wasn't. Well, you were working with Fellini, right?
Yeah, but okay. Not always with Fellini. I mean, I worked also with medium range directors back then, and also with B directors, and it was still fun, you know. Mm-hmm. But I noticed how much more there was much more of an attention back then to the overall quality and also the mechanism. Maybe because I was thinking lately, because back then the movies had to go widescreen. They were blown on the big screen. Now, you know, everything is, sometimes they watch movies even on their phones. So, you know, I think, you know, things move faster and it's okay. But, you know, for us, it's very difficult. So that's what I do. And that requires a lot of concentration. So to think about doing that for a character, I was playing Renfield, and then also to direct. And in fact, I felt like I was sometimes, you know, like going, you know, I don't know, going shipwrecking or something. Because I, even when I was saying my lines on my close-up, I was always looking at the other people. Or I was looking at the set and saying, oh my God, that light is not so great, you know. And things that you don't do, as you know, when we acted. Then we had that beautiful scene, remember, in 4Q with...
Oh, I can't wait to see it.
And Donna and I have a very dramatic scene together. That's all. watch for that too. And it was good, I think. But because I was just thinking, and you were just thinking about it. Yeah. You know, obviously if you're thinking about 3,000
yeah,
other things,
lying.
I wish three. it's taxing, and I guess some people can do it. You know, also because of the way I'm acting, that becomes really difficult. I mean, I'd love to direct, but maybe the next time I would really prefer to just direct, and that would be it.
Do you have any plans to do that?
I have a story that I'm sort of thinking about, but as it is in right now, it's mm-hmm. just a project, and at the very earliest, this is my parrot, the one to say hello,
yeah,
Sierra.
Hello. Actually, I know that you're probably too busy with all of your many film projects to direct right now. So let's talk about one that you just finished.
The two just finished?
Two?
I'm sorry. Oh, yeah. I'm sorry. You mean...
Yeah, I know you're working on a number of film projects now.
Oh, right now. The two movies that just wrapped. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't understand. Of course, the two I just finished. One, it's called Lurker. And mm-hmm. I'd like especially to promote this one because it's a young director, Ernesto Roche. Really, exactly when we were talking about directors, mm-hmm. really working overnight. And I mean, I don't know when the guy has slept last, because he's putting so much effort into this film. And altogether, you're on set. Of course, we'll see the movie later. But I know already. I know already there is something. And, you know, I've done a few films. So for me to be really blown away, you know, by reaching some, I don't want to say anything too big, but I just want to say to reaching something so different than usual, to really be able to go in places where I actually haven't been. Uh-huh. It's been interesting, you know, and I'm very grateful for that too, by the way.
Can you say anything about your character, or is it a surprise?
No, well, it's established from the beginning. This guy is, I'm the second lead. The story evolves around a character, a young man that has lost his memory, and he's sort of wandering around downtown Los Angeles, meeting any sort of people. At one point, he finds help, and he thinks some sort of friendship by a very bizarre transvestite who is not your gross typical, you know, because mm-hmm. I keep my beard and you know, I play a Maya, which is like, you know, interesting because I was like, oh my god, that sounds like I have a gardener or something, a gardener, so, you know, like not something I'd play normally. I play all this ugly man, you know, mad.
You
sour.
Never play. No, if you never played ugly.
Thank you. But
did you keep your mustache then?
Yes, we kept and also everything mainly I have, you know, because there is this contrast. He's wearing this beautiful fitted dress and high heels, fishnets, and a wig, but then he's a guy. And that's what's very interesting and bizarre, and that's also what reveals a double face of the character. I mean, you know, that's the part I cannot tell right now.
Well, you must look beautiful in the film. I mean, your boys look exactly like you. They have your same face. I remember in Virus X, you had really long blonde hair, and you were beautiful. You're beautiful in all your films. So what else besides Lurker?
Lurker, I just did another movie that it's a major movie because it's made by a company like Voltage, who's made even the last Robert Redford movie, The Company You Keep, you know, and many, many others. I mean, they made really huge movies, so I'm really excited. It's going to be, I think, distributed by Universal in the U.S. and Lionsgate. Lionsgate in the U.S. and Universal is doing. Anyways, it's a big project. It stars also Dolph Lundgren and Vinnie Jones, Randy Couture, great actors to work with. And I play a very, you know, a small but extremely key role. I'm sort of like the solution to this case of mysterious disappearance, and that's connected to the Secret Services investigating on a huge drug situation in LA. So that was great. It was great to work with the director, a fantastic director, and then I just feel like this here has just started wonderfully so, because it's been one after another better mm-hmm. films. We did that. We did a movie with Empire, my company, called Travel Well Kamikaze, directed by two twin brothers from Italy, and very young and very visionary. I must thank you on this, my new partner of Empire Films, mm-hmm. Aaron Benoer, because he's overviewed the production on that project with incredible, insightful heart and intelligence. So thank you, Aaron.
Well, you know, I got to talk to Aaron a little today, and he has a degree in mechanical engineering. So, I mean, he's a really intelligent young man. I mean, he probably is very detail-oriented.
Yes. I mean, and that, of course, helps immensely to compensate my not-so-detailed, the more artistic. But no, but it's true. Yeah. I mean, you know, we are...
You're creative.
Yeah, and we are a little bit all over the place. He's much more organized and much more on earth than I'd be. You know, but also overall, it's honesty, it's heart that matters most, and that he has for sure, and you can see mm-hmm. in the type of work. And then,
so what was the name of that film again?
It's called Travel Well Kamikaze. And it's a very original movie. It's all shot on POV, point of view, for the audiences, because it's the protagonist is really the lead character, is uh-huh. the camera. So we see all through the eyes of John, this young man who's planning a terroristic attack in LA.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so it's like very today. Okay.
It's very modern. It's not a genre movie. It's a personal, deeply personal, heartfelt movie.
Okay.
And totally the idea of these two young kids who, you know, it was really challenging and interesting to, if anything else, really freely be able to put on screen what young people are about today and what they think. Oh. You know, and I'm not saying because I feel like such an old timer now, but you know, it's like, because really, I mean, 20 years old today are so different than someone who's 40, because also of the internet, mm-hmm. you know, that as we know, revolutioned our lives and the world and the way we think, the way we work, the way we act, the way we interact.
Were you filming this when Boston happened?
Almost, yeah, just before, which was a sad, very sad coincidence. It was almost like, you know, I was really shocked about Boston. I love that city, always have. I actually have an uncle there. You know, besides, violence shocks me. Mm-hmm. Especially, they tell me sometimes, you know, all this gruesomeness in horror films, you know, I think that's nothing. When you watch the news, the real news,
yeah,
that's a lot scarier.
And it seems like today it's worse, so that your film is very topical. How do you do all these films at the same time? Because I know your first film had a really long shoot, didn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know, since my part, again, is important, but, you know, it appears I have like five, I think, key scenes. You know, the days of production requested weren't so much. So on my days off, we were working on the prepping of, you know, like the welcome, Travel Well Kamikaze. And so I had the time to put together those two. Once I finished, I could start production on Travel Well. Uh-huh. Once we've wrapped that, I immediately go on to Lurker.
Okay.
As you know, we're prepping a very exciting movie called Night to Night, which is an incredible story, can I tell you?
Yes, well, okay, so it's Night to Night with the two.
Yeah, I'd like it to be like that. We'll see what's the, you know, final decisions. That the pencils from the other investors and everybody, the director. But it's been written by two European writers, Andrea Holzen and David Petrucci, and it's also, but it was written in Italian. So yeah, so Aaron, my partner Aaron Bonora, and I rewrote and readapted the old script into English. So yeah, so you know, it is a huge translation. It's not just like translating; it's readapting. Sometimes, it's if you were to just, and I think many people may know, but just to be clear, you know, if you were just to translate word after word, it still wouldn't make sense.
Yeah,
you have to completely readapt a sentence, or to even change it sometimes, because there are really different ways of talking, and so.
Well, for those that don't know, you have dual citizenship, right?
Yes. Okay. Thank you for actually, because I'm a very proud American citizen. Sometimes they always call me Italian, which is, I'm great, I'm very proud of that, but actually I would like to precise that I was never an Italian resident, believe it or not, and I was always an American resident, and
your mom's American, right?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes, yeah, and my dad was Italian, full Italian, 100%, and I have an incredible relationship also with the rest of my family there that I adore, but yeah, you know, even when I was living in Italy, and I've lived there for a long time, I grew up there, but I was always an American citizen, mainly, yeah.
And Domi was discovered by Helmut Newton, right?
Yes, Helmut Newton. I'm another thing I'm very humbled about. Helmut Newton is considered, you know, one of the best photographers in arts and fashion, and I think rightly so. It was, you know, a gift to have met him. And
yeah, and your boys look just like the pictures from that shoot. So Domi's done over 100 films, right?
IMDb says 115.
Oh my gosh. Okay, well, you know, the last time I interviewed Domi was maybe a year ago, I guess. So you've done 50 films since then.
No. I think it's considering also old TV and guest stars appearances, but it's a lot. I mean,
Domi works all the time.
Thank you. I mean, you know, and sometimes, you know, I also can, because as you know, people sometimes think all actors are bound to a movie for the old shoot. Sometimes it is not like that. We have the luxury to go on set on the days our scenes are being filmed. So that allows us to do maybe two at the same time. But nonetheless, it doesn't make it any easier. As you know, I mean, to precise that, it is very complicated, because you're doing two characters at the same time. I mean, obviously not at the same time, meaning at the same day, in the same day, but to switch back and forth is...
Especially when you go through a process like you do. I mean, even though you've been acting a long time and you're a great actor, I'm sure that playing two characters at the same time when you get so invested is difficult.
Very, very difficult to that. It is emotionally a huge challenge. I must tell you, even now, just finishing Lurker the other night, we worked, I think, 18 hours straight. At one point, you know, we had to do all this very difficult scenes, there was some wrestling, you know, everything. We do everything, especially when you have such a part and such a director wanting everything to be good, but really good. I mean, you know, we will do anything for anybody that gives us a chance. And that's what makes makes it so challenging again and again mm-hmm. because it's our life, you know. I think mm-hmm. I'm really alive when I'm acting a character sometimes.
So tell us more about Night to Night.
Night to Night is actually a wonderful project that I was saying.
Does Aaron speak Italian?
No.
Okay, so you translated it from the Italian, and Aaron helped put you into English then.
Yeah, Cinzia Roccaforte was actually a great Italian actress, and I should say movie star. She was the star of a Tinto Brass movie. Called P.O. Box Tinto Brass. That was huge in Europe, and it's available here in the States on Blu-ray. Cinzia was Italian also, and I are basically telling Aaron the meaning of, you know, first of the sense of the old scene, and then really sentence by sentence, line by line, we translate it. And with Aaron, we readapt the writing into an English form that is modern, that makes sense today, and at the same time conveys all what's in the Italian, text. So it's not his job, you know. I was even though that I was very surprised. It's not just about translating, you know. Normal translators just do that. We were doing a lot more.
How long did it take you?
A month.
Wow. Yeah. Okay.
And then plus Aaron and Cinzia Roccaforte has worked for another 2 weeks on top of that on their own while I was shooting Lurker. Yeah.
Okay, so, now what genre is Night to Night?
Night to Night, you know, it's a fantastic film noir. I must tell you, I would say for me it's American Gigolo meets maybe Crash.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay, and what part do you play?
I will play Christian, who is one of the three leads of the movie. He's a very complex character because of a dual doubt that he has. Mainly, is he a good man or is he not? And so that's as much as I can say.
Okay.
Because it's a very thrilling, very mysterious project. He has a lot of huge twists. He has the chance to, and I'm very excited about this, the chance to put together a fantastic cast, really fantastic. Not many characters, but I would say definitely at least 20, which is a good number. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, maybe we'll have a part for you, I think, I hope.
Thank you. I would love to work with you again.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, you're always in our thoughts anyways, but mm-hmm. it's also wonderful to have such an incredibly, you know, gifted, and the generous, kind actors like you are.
Oh, well, thank you.
No, so, that's truth, really. I mean it.
Oh, I love you, Domi. Okay, so let's talk about your next film then. Okay, now before we talk about another film, I know you've had some changes in your personal life. You have two little bundles of joy, and they're not so little anymore. And you look the best I've ever seen you. Tell me your secret.
Thank you. It's a path of the devil, with the devil that I did a few months ago. Yeah, no, I just did some papers, and I'm just kidding. No, it's to tell you the truth, it's been a little bit of stress that makes me completely not famished, not hungry. I'm never hungry. And also watching a little more that for my well-being, trying to really be healthier on what I eat. And hi, Sierra, my parrot. And you know, watching what I eat, mm-hmm. really clean. And also, you know, since we have to cook for my sons, who also obviously need great food, and you know, it's nothing major. It's just that we select very well the ingredients. Everything is biologic and mm-hmm. organically grown and very simple dishes. And I eat a little bit of what we cook for them, but they're so hungry all the time that I eat a little bit, just a very little bit, and maybe I lost weight. Yeah. But I think it was a good choice, you know.
Oh, yeah, you look fantastic. And I hope the boys can come down. Tell us about them.
They are fantastic. They are my pride. I'm absolutely proud of Sky and Thor because they are two wonderful little men. You know, and you can tell already their personalities. Mm-hmm. How they behave, even when they misbehave, there is a wit to them, there is something, a cleverness that is almost disturbing because you think, you know, they're 17, 18 months, so not even 2 years old.
And they're fraternal.
They are fraternal twins, so they do not look alike. They're two different individuals.
But they both look a lot like you.
Thank you. I am flattered. I think actually Sky does look a lot like me when I was 3 or 4, but he's actually not even 2. And that's the part. He's a huge baby. He's a really, really tall.
And Thor used to be the big one.
Yeah. And Thor, you're a good memory. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thor actually was the bigger one and instead leaned out a lot. He's just so athletic and he's got really a very mathematic, organized mind. That's not from me either, by the way. And it is just, they're sweethearts, you know, they just mm-hmm. the way they interacted. It's just amazing to be with them and to just spend time, you know, because you discover the world through the eyes of a child, and that's the most innocent, purest way to do that. And I'm very, very grateful. I am very, very grateful. Thank you.
And they're such good children, too. I mean, look at this house. The two boys run around and I haven't seen them break anything.
Not today, but they they are boys, I mean, of course, mm-hmm. that's part of growing up, and that's also part of a parent to teach them, you know, and I take pride. I also have great help, but, you know, when I'm home, when I'm not working, I really try to stay on them and to teach them, because it's what you teach to an individual always, even in the business environment, you know, mm-hmm. it's such a tough business. Yeah. If we don't protect ourselves, where we would end up, you know.
Yeah.
There is always going to be some, and I'm not saying to just be watching, because that would be a horrible feeling, but just to be careful and to always listen to yourself and to really know that what you're doing is really what you believe in and the best thing to do. And then I think it's already a good start.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so tell us about the last film. Not the last film, because Domi has them lined up for years, but the last film we're going to talk about right now.
Well, this is actually, I have to thank, among other people, I have to thank you, Dawna Lee Heising, because, I mean, this lady is really a wonderful, wonderful person, and besides being a talented actress, the wonderful host that she has, and she's made herself, you know, throughout the years of real hard work. And I have immense respect for all people like myself who have done that, you know, and not, we haven't exploited ourselves on reality shows. We haven't made a show of what's real or not real. We have done work of any kind in the business entertainment that's been, you know, taking us to a certain freedom of choice, mm-hmm. maybe, right?
Yeah, that's a great way to put it, yeah.
Yeah. So thank you, Dawna.
Oh, you're welcome. He's the best for the part.
Massomiliano Cerchi is a director from Italy originally. It was actually, yes, the name of the family, I don't know how is actually, we never really talked, but I know is the Cerchi family is a very famous film family in Italy since ages ago, since I think even from Italian silent films. So yeah, and in any case, he has been very busy with sci-fi, as you know, mm-hmm. and with he was a director, film student in LA, so he knows LA very, very well since the early 90s. And now he has been co-producing with other three partners this movie called The House of Evil 3D, which mm-hmm. is going to be shot in Medellin, Colombia, Puerto Antigua, and all those amazing places. And I saw he had sent me some of the locations. So some of the locations are actually on the website of the movie, which is the Evil House 3D. And it's pretty amazing. So I'm excited also about the opportunity of spending 2 months in Colombia, mm-hmm. which is nearby the Amazons. And I hear you may be coming too, if scheduling allows. So mm-hmm. I mean, that would be fantastic. And it's a great script, and he cast me for the lead. So it's something I'm really looking forward to. Massomiliano seems a fantastic guy, really, 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 really wonderful person. And it's exciting, but again, you know, I'm transitioning right now. I'm deciding who's going to be representing me. I have this great new lawyer that I found through Aaron Benoit and another friend. And his name is Jason Fisher, is also Paris Hilton's lawyer and other people. And is young, but extremely, extremely talented. So he's talking to, you know, WMA, to even CAA, I think, to UTA to find me the best agent, because we had an agent for a while. You know, it's very important that we have the right agent at this point, because mm-hmm. not just for me, but also for Empire Films. You know, whatever I do is so linked to Empire Films. He must be, or she must be, a person that has an entire interest and the power to operate these two mediums together, you know. And and of course, then if they just want Dom as an actor, or if they just want me as a producer, that's totally fine. But you know, it's a lot to do. So when you ask to greater agents, that, you know, you're busy. So it's hard to find. It's easy to find anyone, but it's hard to find the right one who has that power. So right now, really, I'm being called thanks to the work I've done in the past, I guess. And then this happened because of you.
Well, I know you're going to be fantastic in that movie. Okay. So has deciding what to do been part of your stress then?
Yes, I honestly, yes. Okay. Well, there is always, a component. I mean, uh-huh. because, you know, a career is not built out of just thoughts. It's built of what you see and what you do at the very end. And so it's very important to be making the right decisions, not because everything is so centered around me, or, you know, I have also the responsibility of a family, of a household, the birds, my cats, of great partners, and anybody else who's at the very end of the audience is gonna watch a movie. I don't want them to watch a bad movie, mm-hmm. you know, or I don't want them to watch something that does not agree, not even with me. So it's been a real transitional moment. But you know, hey, let me tell you one thing. I'm really happy to be on a transition, because it is from transitions that you always move to another step, to a step above. Mm-hmm. So maybe I'm moving up this time, you know?
So, any last words?
Yes, I'd like to say that, you know, overall, I've been going through a lot of very deep considerations lately, because like you just mentioned, you know, sometimes the stress, sometimes so many decisions, so many important decisions that can affect also so many other people who are close to me or not, but you know, that has always, whatever we do has an effect, and we have to realize that. So I just want to say that it is a moment of transitions, but I also hope that my life is never going to be just, you know, just, there is no arrival, there is no end. I think whatever we do, we're doing it well if we are moving through a path. Mm-hmm. And so it should be transitional, you know, maybe a little less stressful. It can be, definitely, less than it's been, but I'm glad that things have been so shaky, because I know there is a huge change, and it's happening, you know, and there's a lot of light out there, and I'm really looking forward to new sceneries, and I'm excited, I'm grateful for these awards again once more. I cannot thank you and Carla and B enough, and all the people at EOTM. I mean, this is just fantastic. I just want to say really thank you for thinking of me.
Well, thank you for this interview, Domi. You're already an international star, and you're going to be an international superstar.
Okay.
I know. Well, you already are, but an even greater one. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Donna, and my blessings to all of Donna's and the EOTM audience. My best.